Our second speaker needs no introduction, at least for students who have taken a course in cryptography. And we are all very proud to say that he is one of the co-proposers of the AKS primality test. He's the K in the AKS. He's a recipient of numerous awards, which includes a Distinguished Alumnus Award at IIT Kanpur, the Gordell Prize, the Fulkerson Prize, and the Young Scientist Award from INSA, which is Indian National Science Academy, and he won it in 2012. He did his postdoc research at the Institute of Advanced Study in Princeton, and since 2008, he's been working as a researcher in the Microsoft Research Bangalore. So, sir, welcome you.
Thanks for the introduction, and thanks for inviting me here. I want to talk about this problem, the VP versus VNP problem, but this will be mostly motivating the problem rather than giving you too many proofs. So here's the outline of the talk. I'll tell you what we are concerned with. I'll give most of it will be about motivation for this problem and some recent results which seem to come close to resolving this VP versus VNP problem. So let me begin. So the main thing that we'll be concerned with are arithmetic straight line programs, or alternatively also called arithmetic circuits. So let me tell you what straight line programs are. You have a bunch of inputs, x1 through xn. Think of them as integers or complex numbers. And the operations that you allowed are addition, multiplication, and subtraction. So our straight line program will compute like this via sequence of addition, multiplications, and subtractions. And at the end, what you will get is will be some function of the inputs. It will in fact be a polynomial function of the inputs, if you think about it, because when you do these operations, you can think of it as if you're starting with the variables and building a polynomial using these operations. So now the question that we are concerned with, or alternatively, we also like to think of these straight line programs in terms of circuits. So we can represent this computation as a graph. The nodes, the input nodes at the lowest level, they are x1 through xn, the inputs to my program. And we represent the computation like this. Each node here represents a node here, for example, represents a line of the straight line program. It takes as two inputs. So for example, this step is adding things. And often we dispense of subtraction by allowing, these constants are a little, it's not displayed properly. So think of this -1 as a label for this edge going into this plus node. So this plus node then computes this input minus this input.
Steps.
Yeah. Yeah.
Is it allowed to have x1 equal to x1 minus 5 like that?
No. So we don't allow cyclic loops, right? So that our computation is always well defined and it progresses. So we'll see some more examples in just a short while. And the quantities that we'll be concerned with is the size of this program, which is just the number of lines, or if you represent it graphically, it is just the number of nodes in this graph. And we'll also be concerned with the depth of the circuit, which is the length of a shortest path from an input node to the output node. So how tall this graph is. I'll skip this for now. And the questions that we want to understand is the following. What kind of functions can be computed efficiently? So by efficiently we mean with a small number of operations. So which polynomials can be computed with a small number of arithmetic operations? Which of them require large arithmetic operations? And also, we want to understand what is efficient parallel computation. So, what kind of functions or polynomials can be computed efficiently in parallel? So, what does parallel computation mean here? This is very easy, very well defined when you think about circuits. The amount of parallelism refers to the depth of the circuit. If the depth is small, it's a highly parallel computation. You can think of sequential computation as corresponding to tall circuits in which some computation has to be done before other pieces of the computation can proceed. So that corresponds to large depth, and parallel computation corresponds to small depth computation, where the computation graph, there all the paths from input to output are very short, right? So these are two fundamental questions of computer science in general, but right now we are concerned only with arithmetic operations rather than arbitrary Boolean operations. So the corresponding question is here, we can make them into precise mathematical questions. One of them is called the VP versus VNP problem. I will describe it to you in a moment. And the other question, it's called, there's one more name to it called VP versus VNC. Basically, it asks whether computation can, whether every single piece of computation can be efficiently parallelized or not. So you give me a program which might correspond to a very tall, skinny circuit, so it cannot be efficiently implemented in parallel. Can I make another equivalent program which is slightly worse in terms of the total time taken, but the parallel time complexity, I want it to be very small. Is this possible? So let's make these even more precise. So the VP versus VNP question is it true that if I can describe a polynomial efficiently, easily, then the polynomial can also be computed efficiently or not? And for the parallelism, suppose one way to formulate it would be this. Suppose if I give you a circuit of size S, now I want to make the computation highly parallel. So I want to produce another circuit, maybe of slightly larger size, but suppose it, I require it to have only depth delta. So if I want to convert it into an equivalent delta depth circuit, what is the size that is required? Now, by the way, if you can always do this, but the size might blow up exponentially. So the question is, what's the best way to do it? So here are formal definitions. The class VP consists of families of polynomials which have n inputs, which can be computed by polynomial size circuits, say maybe n square size circuits or n cube size circuits. And VNP consists of n variate polynomials again, in which for any given monomial I can compute its coefficient efficiently. So there is a small program which for such that the input to the program is the description of a monomial, what are the degrees of the variables involved in that monomial, and it tells me the coefficient of that monomial. So again, I'll give more examples so that this question becomes more concrete to you. But for now, is there any question? Okay. So that's about the VP versus VNP problem. for the depth reduction, we know some non-trivial lower bounds in this sequence of works. Valiant, Skyam, Berkowitz, Rakoff, and then some more recent pieces of work. At the end, they showed that if you give me a circuit of size S and degree D, so the degree is essentially, think of the degree of a polynomial. It's the sum of the exponents of any monomial, and so for now this degree D here is the degree of the polynomial computed by the circuit. Every circuit computes a polynomial, and the polynomial has a degree. This is denoted by D. So if my circuit computes a polynomial is of size S and computes a polynomial of degree D, then I can have an equivalent circuit of smaller depth delta which has this much size, S to the D to the 2 over delta, and we don't know whether this is optimal or not. So can we do better than this? We don't know in general. And these two questions turn out to be fairly closely related, as we will see. The VP versus VNP problem and this problem. So anyway, let me go on. So let me just mention here that recently, with some additional restriction on the kind of circuits that are allowed, we know that this upper bound that we have is almost optimal.
What is regular?
So regular here will mean all the nodes essentially have the same degree. Slightly relaxed. So the graph is a directed acyclic graph. So you can layer the graph, and at any particular layer, all the nodes have the same degree. That's what regular is. With this restriction, we can show it's optimal, but in general, we don't know. Okay, and there are two related problems of polynomial identity testing and circuit reconstruction, but let me skip this for now. Now, I want to give you lots of examples to motivate these questions. So let's start with a very basic example of integer multiplication. So we want to multiply two integers, two n-bit integers. So very long integers. Think of n as maybe 10,000. So how fast can we do it? Now, if you think about it, we of course know how to do one way to do it that we learnt in school, and the way that we learnt it in school, if you think about it, it takes n square amount of time, because you write down these two n digit numbers, then you take each digit of the second number, multiply it with the first number, then shift it appropriately, and then add these things. And if you think about it, it takes roughly n square amount of time. So the question is, can we do better? So okay, one more observation is that multiplication with powers of 10 is easy, right? Because you just add zeros to the end of the number. So that's very easy. Okay. So I'll tell you this better algorithm. It's not the best algorithm that is known, but it gives you a good flavor of algorithms in this area. So let's take this example of multiplying these two 8-digit numbers in decimal notation. So let me just rewrite this. I write these two numbers essentially in some sense in base 10 to the 4 notation. Just broken up each of these 8-digit numbers into essentially two numbers of 4 digits each, right, in this way. So now call these pieces as A, B, C, and D. think of this 10 to the 4 as a formal variable x. Okay, so actually these pieces are numbered a little wrongly. This 3741 is, think of this as A, this as B. So the first number corresponds to A plus BX, and the same switch you do here. So anyway, so we have these two small degree 1 polynomials that we want to multiply, A plus BX and C plus DX. Now, if you just open this expression, this is AC plus X times AD plus BC plus X square times BD, right? Now, if you think about it, you can do this using 4 multiplications. So what do we want to do? We are given A, B, C and D, and we want to compute this output here. So we want to compute these 4 polynomials, AC, AD plus BC and BD. And so we want to compute these 3 output polynomials. You can do it with 4 multiplications. One multiplication here, A times C, one more here, AD, BC and BD, and then one more addition for the middle guy. Now let's ask this question, can we do it, we want to do it with as few multiplications as possible. So here's our task. Our input are these 4 numbers A, B, C, D. We want to compute these 3 outputs, these 3 polynomials, using as few multiplications as possible. And I will tell you in a while why we are focusing on multiplications, and we will think now of additions and subtractions as being free. So they have zero cost. Now, and I told you already that the trivial algorithm for doing this will take 4 multiplications. Now it turns out you can do it with 3. So this is the trivial way of doing it. Now let me maybe pause for just a second to let you think how you might be able to do it with 3. So here's how. You first compute AC and BD. So you spend your 2 multiplications doing this. But now suppose you first add A and B, C and D, additions are free, and then multiply this. So you have totally done only 3 multiplications till now, and then you subtract this, the first 2 things from this. If you just calculate what this number is, V4, this you can verify that it's exactly AD plus BC, because from this AC and BD have cancelled out, what you are left with is this. Now here's one more thing to verify. Now you can apply this trick recursively. So you are given 2 n digit numbers, break them up, each of those n digit numbers, into 2 pieces of size n by 2 each, apply this trick to multiply these, to multiply the overall thing. But when you recursively, when you are computing this A times C, B times D and these things, recursively apply this same trick, and it turns out that you can already beat the high school algorithm using this. You'll get the running time will be n to the 1.7 roughly.
Is this similar to Strassen's matrix on operations?
Yes, Strassen's came after this. It was sort of inspired by this. Yeah, and I will come to Strassen's algorithm. So now you can ask this question: is this optimal? Is this the best way to multiply 2 numbers? And it turns out that we can do even better than this. In fact, we know the following, and this is one of the few questions in complexity where we know the answer exactly. In this area, it's very easy to ask very simple questions, which are interesting, which have practical relevance also. But usually we don't know the answer. This answers seem very difficult. In this particular case, we know the answer exactly. And it turns out that if you give me two polynomials of degree n, and we want to multiply them, I can do it with exactly 2n plus 1 multiplications, and that's the best you can hope for. And so the trivial way would have been n square, but we can do it with all linear. In fact, we know exactly how linear, 2n plus 1, and that's the best. Now, let me go on to matrix multiplication. And this, I'll tell you about Strassen's algorithm. Now, so we had great success in multiplying two numbers. Now, let's ask, how about multiplying two matrices? So, we want to multiply two n by n matrices. So, let's start with two 2 by 2 matrices. So, here are two 2 by 2 matrices. We want to multiply them and compute this product, which is this resulting 2 by 2 matrix. So, equivalently, we want a circuit which has 8 inputs. The 4 entries of this, the 4 entries of this, and we want the output to be the 4 entries of the product matrix, right? Now, again, if you think about it, there's a trivial algorithm to do it, which will involve 8 multiplications. So, each of these entries of the output, it's a quadratic polynomial with two terms. So, this term and this term. You can compute each of these terms using one multiplication. So, two operations for each entry of the output, eight operations overall, 8 multiplications overall. Now, like before, let's ask this question, can you do it better? And it turns out, so this is just the way of representing the trivial algorithm for matrix multiplication. Just so that you get a feel for arithmetic circuits, that arithmetic circuits sort of can, they correspond to the kind of questions that we are interested in. So here is how you would represent the trivial way of multiplying 2n by n, 2 by 2 matrices. Right? Now in the 60s, late 60s, Strassen found this much more clever way of multiplying 2 by 2 matrices. He could do it with 7 multiplications. So, I won't describe the full thing, but it turns out that here's the key thing. Now, at the intermediate stage of this algorithm, it computes these 7 quadratic polynomials that I have listed here. How these 7 quadratic polynomials come about, I won't explain. It seems very magical at first. But once I tell you that you have to, in the intermediate step, compute these 7 things, the rest of it is very straightforward. You can figure out for yourself what other operations to do here and what other operations to do later. So, for example, each of these 7 things, you can see it's a linear form, a degree 1 polynomial times another degree 1 polynomial. So, and since additions and multiplications are free, you would compute them in the natural way. Just for example, for this guy, first subtract x4 from x2, separately add y3 and y4, and then multiply them. The natural thing to do. And then also, these 7 things are not what we want. We want some other four set of polynomials. And then you have to take appropriate linear combinations of these seven guys, and it turns out that all the four things that we want can be obtained using these seven guys. For now, this is just take it as something that you have to verify. I won't explain how these seven magical quantities came about. And now, it turns out that if you just verify this and then make it into an algorithm in the natural way, so once again, you have to apply it recursively. You are given a large n by n matrix, sort of use this to do the matrix multiplication, but when you have to multiply submatrices, recursively use this again. And if you do that, and if you look at the time complexity, it turns out to be n to the log 7, roughly n to the 2.8, whereas the trivial algorithm for matrix multiplication, if you think about it, would have taken time n cube, n to the 3. Now, there are, so we get something better than the trivial. Now, there are two questions one can immediately ask. Can we do better? Can we do it in, say, n square time, very ambitiously? But we don't know that.
What is the equivalent of that, 2n plus 1?
Here, matrix multiplication, lots of questions are open. So, for example, here, even for 2 by 2 matrix multiplication, you can ask this question. Can I do it in less than 7? Can I do it with 6 multiplications or not? And this was open for a long time, for almost 40 years. And only like 7, 8 years ago, it was shown that 7 is necessary. You cannot do it with less than 7. But in general, for n by n for multiplying to n by n matrices, we don't know what the right answer is. The best lower bound that we have is something like 3n square, whereas the best upper bound that we have is here, n to the 2.37. And so there's a big gap between the upper bound and the lower bound that we have. So in short, we don't know. So let me take one more example. Now I'm coming more towards the VP versus VNP problem. So far the examples that you saw were very numeric in nature. So let's take a combinatorial problem with combinatorial flavor. It's about computing Hamiltonian cycles in a graph. So for example, here's a graph. And I want to tell you about Hamiltonian cycles. So a Hamiltonian cycle in a graph is a cycle which goes through every vertex exactly once. So for example, in this graph, the red edges form a Hamiltonian cycle, right? It goes through each vertex exactly once. Now one can ask this question, given a graph, does it have a Hamiltonian cycle? And we know that this problem is likely to be very difficult. So there's a famous open problem called P versus NP. And one way to state it is this. Can this problem be solved efficiently? So given a graph G, can we determine whether it has a Hamiltonian cycle or not efficiently? We believe the answer is no, but we can't prove it. We don't really know. Now, I'll tell you what the arithmetic version of this problem is. So, to do that, I'll have to tell you about the Hamiltonian problem, some way of arithmetizing this problem. So, to do that, consider the complete graph on n vertices. So this is the complete graph on n vertices. And now, so this thing here should be xij. It's not showing up. So take the complete graph on n vertices. Now take the edge joining I and j, the ith and the jth vertex, and label it with a variable xij. Right? So the way to think about it is, when you are given an actual graph, xij will be either 0 or 1 depending on whether the edge is present or not present. Right? It will be 1 if the edge is present, 0 otherwise. Now form this polynomial in the Hamiltonian polynomial. It's defined like this. It goes over all the Hamiltonian cycles in the complete graph. So for example, one Hamiltonian cycle could be just start from 1, go to 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, n, and then after n come back to 1. So just the outside cycle here, right? And then for that Hamiltonian cycle, it will correspond to one monomial in this polynomial. It is the product of all the variables that you encounter on the edges of the cycle. So for example, if you were to take this cycle, it would be x12 times x23 times x34 and so on times xn1. So multiply all the variables that you encounter on the edges of the cycle, that's one monomial, and then go over all the cycles. Now why is this interesting? Well, the one immediate thing to notice here is the following, that when we are actually given a graph, so then in that case all the xij's will be either 0 or 1. In that case, let's focus on one monomial. So each monomial corresponds to a Hamiltonian cycle, and notice that if any edge along that cycle is absent, so then the corresponding variable will be set to 0, so the monomial will become 0. Otherwise, if all the edges are present, the monomial will have value 1. So using this reasoning, you can see that if all the xij's are 0 or 1, then the value of this polynomial is exactly the number of Hamiltonian cycles in the given graph. Just from what I told you, right? Now, so what this means is that if we could compute this polynomial efficiently using few arithmetic operations, we could also answer the Hamiltonian cycle problem. We could solve that also. So in fact, we could do much more. We could in fact tell you the number of Hamiltonian cycles, not only whether there exists a Hamiltonian cycle or not. So now one can ask, can this polynomial be computed efficiently? So let's see what I mean by efficiently here. Now, the way I have described this polynomial to you, it immediately gives you some algorithm, maybe very bad algorithm, to compute this polynomial. And it turns out in this case, this polynomial has like roughly n factorial monomials, the number of Hamiltonian cycles in a complete graph, certainly exponentially growing in n. So the trivial way to compute it will require exponential time, computing it monomial by monomial. And now one can ask, can we do better? Can we do it, let's say, hopefully in n square time or n cube time, some poly n time? And that's exactly another way to restate the VP versus VNP problem. This is an equivalent restatement of this problem. Can I compute the Hamiltonian problem, a polynomial, efficiently? And efficiently here is poly n. So think of this as maybe n to the 100 number of operations. we believe that the answer is no, but we don't know. So this is the open problem. So any questions so far?
By the way,
yeah,
the theme of the analysis has been over ensembles. How much of this theory would work for one particular example and insight into its of a particular example given to you?
Yeah, so here, yeah, so the question is, another way that we would put it is, here we are more concerned with asymptotics, ensembles of sequences of polynomials, rather than one fixed polynomial.
Yeah, that could be very large,
yes,
a huge one, but what, yeah, insight will it give to that particular one?
Yeah, so it's not completely clear that for a fixed thing it will give insight, but usually it has happened that when we solve these asymptotic questions, it gives some reasonable upper and lower bounds for specific families. So, specific members of the family that you are concerned about, and in general, even other polynomials. So, for example, work on matrix multiplication, people were often concerned with asymptotics, multiplying to n by n matrices, but now because of that work, we know, for example, if you want to multiply to 4 by 4 matrices, we know some reasonable upper and lower bounds for doing that.
Okay, but it still, there is some ensemble you have to take. And the reason is, in many cases in applications, you get one problem and then you basically have to solve that one problem with the numbers given to you.
Yeah, so yeah, here for now we are more concerned with asymptotics. But there's one more problem that I sort of skipped over quickly called reconstruction, that is more related to this specific things that you are asking. But for now I'll just be concerned about asymptotics with ensembles of polynomials.
There was these results about smooth kinases and simplexes, polynomial time, blah blah blah. Have similar, I'm sure people have attempted to do it in this field. Any significant results over probabilistic simplexes?
Here, smoothed analysis. I mean, the smoothed analysis itself has had some applications here for the reconstruction problem, but not for the VP versus VNP question. There's no sort of analog here. Exactly. Okay. Let me mention one more thing before I go on to the recent results. One more combinatorial problem that you can consider is bipartite matching. Given a bipartite graph, does it have a perfect matching or not? So a bipartite graph has 2n vertices, n vertices here, n vertices on the right, n vertices on the left, and all the edges go from left to right. It's an undirected graph, and a perfect matching is a set of n edges which such that each vertex is adjacent to exactly one edge. So for example, in this bipartite graph, the set of red edges form a matching, a perfect matching. So now you can think of a matching as simply a permutation from 1 through n to 1 through n. So for example, this will correspond to the permutation 1 maps to 2, 2 maps to 3, 3 maps to 4, and 4 maps to 1, right, in the natural way. So which vertex on the right is matched to which vertex on the left, that gives you a permutation. Now similar to what we did for the Hamiltonian, you can form a, starting from the complete bipartite graph, you can form a polynomial, let's call it the matching polynomial, which has the property that if the variables on the complete graph were 0 or 1, that means corresponding to whether the edge is present or not in the given graph, then the value of the polynomial would be exactly the number of matchings in the graph. Now, one can ask, can this polynomial be computed efficiently? It turns out we don't know the answer. So this is just the basic property of this polynomial. And now one can ask, can it be efficiently computed? We don't know. But there's a very closely related polynomial to it. You just append signs to each of these monomials in a fixed way. So the sign is plus 1 if the corresponding permutation is even and minus 1 otherwise. It turns out that this polynomial is exactly the determinant of an n by n matrix. And it turns out the determinant, we know how to compute it efficiently because we have done linear algebra, but we know something more. We know that the determinant can be computed efficiently in parallel also. So by this, what we mean is there exists a circuit whose depth is just log n, actually log square n, and size is n cube, which can compute the determinant. So see, overall, the number of operations required to compute the determinant is n cube. So if the computation had been very sequential, inherently sequential, you'd have the depth of the circuit would have been n cube or close to it. But it turns out that you can squash the circuit a lot. You can make it of depth log square n. And as a result of it, you can also test whether a given bipartite graph has a matching or not in parallel efficiently. And this is basically the only algorithm, the only efficient parallel algorithm that we have for matching. Though there's one, yeah.
When you do the computations efficiently, by any chance, are you increasing the additions factorial
depth? So I guess the question is, when we have this n cube sized circuit for the determinant, are we allowing free additions or not? No. Here, this is really n cube in that I count the cost of additions as well as the multiplication. So everything is counted. There's no cheating here. But there's one small caveat here that if you think about it, using the determinant to compute matchings, this requires some randomness, some use of randomization, and we don't know how to do this deterministically. So this is one more open problem in this area. So this was just to give you a flavor of this area, why we care about these problems. Yes.
Just a remark, the Hamilton circuit was preempted by developments in India many centuries before. Vedanta Deshikar, Ratnakara, etc. had solved a nice tube problem on a chessboard using Sanskrit slokas. Oh. Earliest known solution to the nice tube problem is from India.
Oh, is it? Okay.
It's not correct to use the word Hamilton only. You say Ratnakara, Vedanta Deshikar, Hamilton circuit.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So what he is referring to is, you can take a chessboard and you can think of the squares on the chessboard as nodes in a graph, and how the knight, the allowed moves of the knight correspond to connections on the nodes, and the Hamiltonian cycle in this graph corresponds to a knight's tour on the chessboard. And it was known that from India that how to, that there exists a knight's tour for the entire chessboard, right?
Yeah, they have this actually, it's constructive. There's actually two Sanskrit shlokas you can write down, and you can read the second shloka from the first, and you will get the knight's tour. So it's not just, it's much more than just a tour. It is semantic. The two shlokas are semantically meaningful on the same subject. In the case of the Ratnakara, it's a war being described. In the case of the Bajrangi, Lord Sitarama, described. So it has one several layers of complexity on top of this.
Oh. So let me mention some recent results. So now one of the central problems in this area is the VP versus VNP problem, and in some sense some recent results have come close to solving this, but you should take that with a grain of salt. We still don't know the answer. So one way to think about it is that maybe it's an approach to solving this problem. So let me tell you about this. So there's this seminal result of Valiant et al., which says that you can take any circuit of size S and degree D, and you can simulate it with a small depth, with a delta depth circuit of size roughly S to the D to the 2 over delta. So for example, if you plug in delta equal to log D here, then what this means is that if you take any circuit of size poly n, then there's an equivalent circuit of size again polynomial in the original circuit size, which is overall just a polynomial, but the depth is much smaller, log D. So here I've just put S equal to poly n and delta equal to log D. So you can, the blow up is only polynomial. So this was used in some of the earlier pieces of work. Now you can also think of, now take delta to be 4 here. So you can take any circuit of polynomial size, and there is an equivalent depth 4 circuit of size roughly n to the root d, which computes the same polynomial. Now the main thing here is that the depth is much smaller, depth 4. So depth 4 circuits look like this. There's a addition gate at the top at the output, followed by a layer of multiplication gates, then a layer of addition gates, then another layer of multiplication gates. So that's it, just 4 layers of gates with unbounded fan-in. And now, so one way to try to prove the VP versus VNP problem is the following. You can try to prove lower bounds for homogeneous depth 4 circuits. So suppose, like take for example the Hamiltonian polynomial. Suppose you could show that that particular polynomial does not have depth 4 circuits of size n to the root d. Suppose if you could show this, then if you just apply this theorem in the contrapositive, in the reverse direction, then it will imply that the Hamiltonian does not have polynomial size circuits. So proving these kind of n to the root d kind of lower bounds for depth 4 circuits might be one approach to prove circuit lower bounds in general. And the why we hope to be able to do this is that depth 4 circuits sort of correspond to very nice arithmetic expressions, which maybe we can analyze more easily. So here's a recent result. So there exists a family of polynomials. It's not quite the Hamiltonian family, but for now you can think of FD as maybe the Hamiltonian polynomial. It's not, it's morally correct to say you can just think of FD here as Hamiltonian polynomials, such that if you write it as a depth 4 circuit. So here's the nice thing. So a depth 4 circuit computing a polynomial is an expression like this. It's a sum of product of homogeneous polynomials. And let me just remind you what homogeneous polynomials are. Homogeneous polynomials are polynomials in which all the monomials have the same degree. So whatever the degree is, it's the same across all the monomials. So if you, for any expression of, for FD of this kind, the number of monomials, the total number of monomials which corresponds to the size of the circuit must be at least 2 to the root d log d. And it turns out from what I just told you, so there's a, the lower bound is 2 to the omega root d log d. So there's a constant here, so maybe the constant is 1. Now if you can improve it slightly, suppose if you could improve it to an asymptotically anything better than root d log d in the exponent. So little omega here means something which is anything better than root d log d, slightly larger, maybe root d, log log d. If you could do that, then it will immediately imply that Vp is different from Vnp. So yeah, but we don't know how to do this now. So that's it. So any questions?
By the way, this is with the Turing-machine model of computation.
Yeah.
Any analogs in the real number, Smale-Bloom type model, would you have the same results?
Yes. So in the Bloom-Smale model, if you can prove lower bounds there, it will imply lower bounds for the, like it can potentially resolve the original P versus NP question. You have to prove good lower bounds in the Bloom-Smale. You have to prove sufficiently good lower bounds in the Bloom-Smale model.
Okay, yeah. Those are open.
Those are open. Yes, those are very much open. Yes.